In the latest version of Angular, we're getting what's known as the new control flow syntax for our component templates. It will replace older directives for things like ng-if-else, ng-switch, and ng-for. In this video, we're going to learn exactly what this change means for us and how to use it. All right, let's get to it. So for those of us that are used to building things in Angular, we're used to using the structural directive ng-if and the concept of using an ng-template for the else condition when needed. Well, we don't need this anymore with the new control flow syntax. Also, we no longer need to import the common module to use them. Let's take a look at an example. Okay, here in our component, we have this player object consisting of some data about NBA player LeBron James. If we were to imagine that in the real world, data like this may come from an API request where it may contain data or just be undefined. We would then need to conditionally use it within our template. In this case, we want to show our player component and pass it the player data only when it's been defined, so we need to use an if condition. For the new syntax, it's a little similar to other templating languages like PHP, Razor, and others. We start with the at symbol. Then, in parentheses, we add our condition. Here it will be if our player value is truthy. And then we wrap whatever conditional item, in this case it's our player component, with a player input, and that's it. Right now, of course, it's showing because we have our data hard-coded, so let's go clear it out. And when we save, now we can see that it's properly removed when no data is provided. Here, if we want to show a message when we have no data, we need to add an else statement. To do this, we just need to add another at symbol, then the word else, then a new set of curly braces where we wrap our message. Then, when we save this, we see that our message is properly displayed because we have no data. So that's the new syntax replacing the old ng-if-else. Next up, we have the new syntax for switch statements. We no longer need a wrapping element or ng container in order to use an ng switch directive and each of its cases. In this example, we have a select control where we can choose LeBron, Kareem, or leave it as the default player. And when we look at our data, we have three player objects: player one, LeBron; player two, Kareem; and player three, Karl Malone. What we want to do in the template is show the appropriate player to match the value from our form control. This control will be a value of a string matching either LeBron, Kareem, or default. So back in our template, we'll begin by adding the at symbol, followed by the word switch. Then, in parentheses, the value that we'll want to switch on. In this case, that will be our options control value. Now for our first case, we add the at symbol, then the word case, followed by the value, LeBron for this case, in parentheses. Then within curly braces, we add our player component, the player input. In this case, it will be player one because that was LeBron in our data. Now we can simply copy all of this, paste, then change the case to Kareem, and the input to player two, this time for Kareem's data. And finally, we can add our default case. We'll add the player component one last time here, and we'll pass it player three for Karl Malone. Okay, now when we save, we see Karl Malone since he was the default, and our control value is set to default when initialized. If we change it to LeBron, the view is properly updated. And likewise with Kareem. So that's the new switch syntax. Up next, we have the final example in this video, a for loop. For this, we used to need an element or ng container for our ng-for directive. Then we would need to create a variable from a list of options, and then much of the time, we would need to add a trackby function to help with the performance. Well, it looks similar now, but a little different. In this example, our list of players is larger and consists of all these items. We want to list these players out in the template with a for loop. So we start by adding the at symbol again, then the word for followed by parentheses. In these parentheses, we create our variable. We'll call it player. Then, like the old ng4, we use the word of followed by our variable for our list data, in this case, players. Now, one of the key differences in the new syntax is that a track expression is now mandatory. So if I were to save this, we get an error letting us know what we're missing. So we need to add a semicolon followed by the word track. Then we need to provide a unique value to track, something like an ID, but in our case, we'll use the player name. Okay, all that's left now is to add our player component and pass it our player data. And now when we save, there's our list of players. Now, what if our list was empty and we want to show a message? Well, let's clear out our list data, and after saving, we just have a blank screen. To show a message in this case, we go back to our template, and we can add an empty scenario for a for loop. And inside, we can add our message. Now when we save, we see our message. Pretty easy, right? Now for those of you familiar with the old ng4, you may be wondering about all the old properties that we had available, like index, first, last, even, odd, and count. Well, they all still exist in the new syntax too. We just add them much like we did before. We use the word let followed by the variable name we want to use, then equals, and then the name of the value prefixed with a dollar sign. So after adding all of these, I want to display the count in a message before the first item in the list. So I add a condition for the first item. Then add my message with the string interpolated value for the list count. When we save, now we can see the message with the count before all items. And let's say I want to display the list item number next to the player name. We can do this by passing the item index to the player component. Internally, that component adds 1 to its index value if it has it and places the string interpolated value before the name. We could also add some zebra striping by binding a class even to all the even numbered list items. Now we can see all the even items are a little darker. And finally, we can highlight the first and last items by binding a first and last class to those variables. Here we can see the first item gets a red border, and when we scroll down to the bottom, the last item gets a blue border. Pretty straightforward, right? So I think this is a pretty nice change. It's pretty similar to what we're used to, but it's a little more simple. It doesn't require as many elements, ng containers, and ng templates, and it also doesn't require any imports, which is pretty nice. I guess some things are simpler, some things are easier, and some things are just different. And for those of you who may be worried about making this change to an existing code base, don't be. To migrate all of your existing ng ifs, ng switches, and ng fors, you can simply use the migration schematic, which should hopefully update them without much work at all. Okay, so that's pretty much all I have for Angular's new control flow syntax. Until next time, thanks for watching.